All right, so I think now's a good time to actually work through the first scenario here in No Question of Surrender. This really is a learning scenario. In fact, it just states that basically as the description. It says it's short and designed for those learning the rules. And as a learning scenario, it doesn't include every aspect of the game, and it's only two turns long, so it's not even very long at all. So you won't really see a lot of the depth that the systems will provide over time necessarily. But it will give you a good example of, say, how to move your units around, sort of the effects of barrages, and how to begin to conduct, or in this case, really not conduct an assault with adequate forces. As you can see here, this is the French position, the setup position. You do get some sort of ability to choose what you'd like to set up here. You can kind of see a little red dotted outline. That is sort of one area. As you do the fuller game, the more the campaign, I should say, the campaign game, there's three or four different deployment areas where you can move guys around within the larger fort of Bir Hakeim. I did not look up the phonetic pronunciation of this, sorry. It's been a couple of days since I made the other video. I just haven't done it. Maybe if I do it later, I'll correct myself, but we'll just go with this brutal butchering here of Bir Hakeim. Or Bir Hakeim or whatever. So as you can see here, what's really interesting, of course, is that we have essentially a lot of infantry. It's what these guys are with the circles. You can tell that, well, one, you learn this kind of, like we discussed before, the sort of the symbols used here are the actual fighting forces of the time, historical ones they would have used. So I'm not sure if this is like French or if this was just sort of the Free French designation. But anyway, those are infantry. And they do not have any firing range. If you remember, we looked at values here. They do have an assault rating of 2, a firing rating of 5. So if they can fire on something like 1 hex away, but they can't fire anything more than that. And some other units we have here, of course, we have our leader. He's leading. This is like who's that? Lieutenant Colonel Emile Cavere. This is a machine gun unit. They actually represent by squares. It has a range of 2, so it's actually one of the few range units. We also have here a, what is this? This is sort of a dual purpose gun. And it's one of the few units here that will actually cause barrage results and can conduct opportunity fire, which we will see as for the Italians, that's going to be very devastating for them. Actually, if you play this game with an opponent, you get to set up this unit and another dummy unit face down so that the opponent does not know which one has the actual gun position. Because obviously they're going to kind of want to go for that and see if they can knock that out because it's one of the few things that can hurt them as armored units are attacking. And underneath there is yet another infantry unit. Over here is a mortar unit, and you can kind of tell because a lot of the mortar units have the sort of either look like a mortar or as this one sort of has the arrow through the square there. And also the big way in the Grand Tactical series to tell it's a mortar unit is that it has the green firing rating here of 3. Big thing about mortar units are that they cannot conduct opportunity fire, which is their big disadvantage. So during their rounds, they can attack and they have a great range of 6. They can spot for themselves, which is very nice because there is sort of radio. There are radio contact rules for indirect spotting, and that requires like another unit of that formation to see the target. You have to conduct rolls to make sure that the artillery unit, if it's conducting indirect fire, can actually stay in contact and whatnot. That's a little more complicated. We won't really see that here in this game because the targets will all be in direct line of sight and we won't need to rely on indirect spotting. So I'll kind of zoom out here and what we'll do is we'll take a look and get a larger look at the board here. So you can see I've demarcated here the training scenario, the scenario 1, it limits where you're at the total map. It's actually a very small section of the map. I'll zoom in a little bit there. There we go. So the main thing is the road here. This is the Bir Hakeim road, I'm guessing. And here is where the Italians are moving in. This is actually the historical attack conducted by the Italians on May 27th, 1942. It's actually just one Italian of tanks, and this was far less than Rommel had actually desired to attack because I'm not so sure about the actual composition of the defenders, if this is all they had, but this is a fairly light force, but of course it can easily handle 3 tanks, as we're going to see here, but we're going to learn a lot about movement, moving in column, conducting opportunity fire, fire zones, some of the key concepts, also spending command points and whatnot, and pulling chits. I mean, it's enough to give you a lot of the basic system. It's not going to go into a lot of the deeper mechanics like air power. or even dispatch points. We won't worry about dispatch points in the training scenario. If you have a scenario that's longer than a couple of turns, dispatch points are used to purchase formation chits and whatnot so that you can allocate them for future use. It's one of the more intriguing aspects of this system and the chit pull mechanics. The fact that you get dispatch points, you have to plan ahead because it costs more to get them sooner. I won't go too much into it, but that's definitely something you won't see here in the training scenario. It's definitely involved in the larger games, or the larger scenario games, I should say. This one is purely just to get some of the combat mechanics out of the way, and that's exactly how I'm going to treat it. It is definitely a learning scenario. I'm going to go through the procedures, the flowcharts. If you're familiar with Grand Tactical series, this will be boring. This will not be exciting for you to watch. If you are new to it, just as I am, I've played some on Vassal. This will be really some of my real pushing around counters on a physical board, messing with the numbers in my head. You can see up here I've made some notes. These are actually bonuses that the units inside Bir Hachim, if they don't move and don't trigger opportunity fire or assault out of those hexes, they get some nice defensive bonuses here. And so, you know, in the Vassal module, that's already automatically incorporated in their values here. Here we'll have to kind of remember it. So, you know, hey, plexiglass, nice, you can write it down. So anyway, this scenario is only two turns long. And it begins here with this formation chit already drawn and activated. So this is, let's see if I can get my thing to focus on it. It's 132 Corizio. Actually, is that Corizato? Sorry. It's this formation chit. And formation chits are actually kind of nice in this game because it gives your units the ability to conduct the widest range of actions. You still have to pay command points for it, but you can actually do quite a lot more. Whereas other chits you pull, then they sort of have more restrictions on what actions you can take. And we'll see what those are, and I'll explain those as we draw them. So in the scenario begins here, the goal for the Italians is they have three tank units here. And I'll zoom in, I'll get a little closer. Actually, let's get closer and take a look at our Italian units. Okay, so besides our standard leader token here, we have three of these. So I can get that a little better. There we go. Some fairly nice tank units here. It's got nice 18 movement. It's tracked, as we can see by the red value for the movement there, 18. It has a troop quality rating of 5. It's got a fire rating of 3. It has a range of 3. It has a soul value of 2. And when it's not modified by any sort of marker, it has a natural defensive rating of -1. So, you know, fairly potent tank unit here. And three of these representing one battalion, you know, you can imagine if they had brought three battalions along, this would be a much, much more potent force that could easily overwhelm the defenders. As it was, only one battalion came, so that's what we're going to get, and that's what we're going to deal with here. Now, as the rules state, when you bring a unit in as in reinforcements, you can decide if they come in column or not. Column is a big deal in this game because it really directly relates to movement. Because there are no zones of control, there's a lot more to do with sort of movement ratings and also what we call fire zones. We're going to see a lot more about fire zones in a minute, but let's just talk movement ratings now. In this game, because it takes place in the desert, we don't really have a lot of crazy terrain. Obviously, it's just going to be desert terrain. So let's see, do I have the desert? Oh yes, so okay, as we can see here, I'm going to put my adult beverage in the corner. Hello, adult beverage. Zoom back out. So here we go. That's what I'm looking for. So there's a couple other minefields here. We'll talk about those. Those mainly can conduct suppression results if you fail troop quality checks. We'll talk about that in a second. Or not troop quality checks, if you fail like a minefield roll. I'm not going to go into it right now. As we get to it, I'll actually look up the rules. I made a nice player aid for that, so ignore my rambling there. But as you can see here, because this game has very limited terrain, we're only going to really deal with deserts. And that's okay with me, because as this game is more designed to be sort of an introductory into the whole system, and while the larger scenarios do incorporate some of the more full aspects of the whole entire system mechanics, you're going to get a little lighter treatment on things such as terrain. That's just the nature of desert warfare, right? Although that's not really a knock, honestly. Desert warfare does have varied terrain, and you could have settings where that is done. And hey, hint, hint, that would be a lot of fun to see more of, because, you know, I don't necessarily need, like, a full range of terrain as we see sort of in Europe, but, you know, maybe some of the coastal areas, something with a little more variety in the desert, and a sort of scale around this size, maybe a little bigger. Hey, that would be interesting to me. Anyway, that's a digression. So we see here desert. You see here leg, wheel, tract. Those are the three different colors and types of movement. So if you remember, we looked at the tank units, they had the red value there, so tract units. You see two values here, 2, 1, 5, 3, 3, 2. This means is a unit not in column, is a unit in column. Not in column, as you can see, is much higher because obviously that represents your unit being sort of in battle formation, moving maybe a little scattered, not necessarily in a tight, ready to move formation. For leg units, that's nice. The benefit is nice. You know, like you get a double movement. Leg guys can also sort of just even in battle formation, or I should say non-column, they can walk into cities or cross bridges, I believe. But sort of wheeled or tracked units have to be in column to cross bridges to get into cities. And the other thing is that you can't stack column units. So you can have a stack of, in this game, the scale is a little different than others. So you can have three units stacked together and an additional one in column, but you couldn't, say, have two units of column stacked together. So even though I've started the game here, units in column, you can bring them in, they can stay illegally stacked, but they can't remain that way until the end of the turn. It's one of those funky, you know, entry rules. If you play war games, you know what I'm talking about. The stacking gets applied later. Anyway, back to movement. I'm sort of digressing in all sorts of places here. The reason that this exists and I brought my units into column is because they get more advantageous movement rates. So here in the desert, we have tracked units. If for every space they move, it would cost three, but in column, it only costs two. And even if that's a small advantage, because this scenario is only two turns long, you got to take every kind of advantage you can get in movement because you've got to approach the enemy and hopefully force them out of space. The goal for the Italians to win this is to get one unit in the fort unsuppressed. It has to remain unsuppressed and get into technically a fort hex. So that's the goal there. I brought them into column because the rules state that a unit can go into column by paying a cost. I believe it is maybe. It pays a movement cost. So I'm not going to talk about it until I actually look it up. But you can't leave column unless you take a cohesion hit. So you can, in a turn, stay normal and then enter column. And then on your next turn, if you move, or next activation, I should say, on your next activation, you could say, if your unit was in column, then you could move and then jump out of column without a penalty, but you cannot enter column in a turn and then leave column in that exact same turn without paying the penalty of taking a cohesion hit. And cohesion hits are how you build up step losses. They affect your whole ratings on your entire unit, and we'll see how those work because it will get bloody fast. That was a long way and a lot of explanation to say that I put these units into column because I want them to get up to the front faster, and I can, if they start in column, they can now leave column this turn. Because technically, them starting in column was not me putting them that way in an activation. That's just how they're going to come onto the board as reinforcements. So, you know, some of those rules you got to master in these kind of games, right? You have to learn when units can freely sort of be in column or not, and so that way they don't get penalized because movement here is a big deal, and you may not get activations, you know, back to back or what you want. So, those are one of those little tricks you have to kind of master, and I haven't mastered it at all. I just know those kind of things from reading rules and playing these kind of games, and I can see immediately from having played this on Vassal, we're mastering that sort of when units can freely enter and exit column without penalty. You gotta learn those things. Anyway, they're starting in column. That's a long way to explain that. What does column do? Well, it reduces your fire rating here by one, as you can see. It also increases your defensive rating. So these guys have already got a -1 value, but now they will have a +2. So that makes them actually, when they're in column, +1. And you also lose one to your assault rating because when you're in column, you're not obviously in a battle formation. You're obviously just sort of either a straight line or sort of compacted together to make for easy movement, easy, fast movement. Anyway, they're in column and they start the game. The game says that they start with their chit drawn first. So here we go. Let's go ahead and jump to the action. I've talked a lot about what's going on. The weather's clear. We won't see any weather effects for this kind of scenario because it is just short in a learning scenario. Okay. So when I look at the map here, we'll go with it. We have a little bird's eye look here. What are some of my thoughts and approach? Well, I can't go north or south of that, right? So those are my sort of border lines. I do know that if I get on a road, that the trail, actually, we missed this on the terrain effects chart over here. Limited though it is, we did miss the trail one. And trail says all vehicles in column cost 1 MP. So if I can get to a trail hex, then everything's 1 MP into here. Now, one thing that I have to be careful of is the firing range, or firing zones, I should say, of units that are here defending the hex. Now, the infantry, as we discussed earlier, don't have any, or they have a fire range of 1, right? Because if it's not printed, it's assumed to be 1. But we have a couple of units, particularly these two units, the, what is that, the anti-char? I know I'm going to, since I'm not well-versed in military affairs, some people are going to laugh because I just will be so oblivious to some of these things, but this, I'm assuming, is some sort of artillery gun. It is the 3-1 anti-char. I don't know what that is or what that means, but that's what it's designated as. And then we also have a mortar unit here. Now, as I said before, the mortar unit can't conduct opportunity fire, so as our units advance up here, the mortar unit won't be able to get free pot shots at them. So that's one nice advantage. Unfortunately, this artillery gun here, it can conduct opportunity fire. And opportunity fire can be conducted as many times by a unit as it is capable of performing. We'll discuss that in just a second. That's a little different than some games where maybe a unit is spent if it uses its opportunity fire. The only way to have opportunity fire work, though, is you have to pass a troop quality check. And that's not necessarily a given for this guy, because he does have a 4, although his troop quality is +1 for being in the fort, so he does have a troop quality of 5. You have to roll, I believe, and get under that number. So it's not so easy with the lower numbers, the higher ones, much easier to pass, of course. So it is possible that your units can sneak up, but every time they can trigger opportunity fire, you can see which units are capable of doing so. If there's a unit in their firing zone, then they can trigger it. And as we get closer, we'll discuss sort of what it means to move into a fire zone and trigger opportunity fire. Let's focus now on just getting our guys up to the road and moving down here, because as good Italian soldiers are, they're following orders and they are going to disperse these wretched free French criminals and vagabonds and, you know, various other unwanted people from the line. Okay, how much movement do our units have? 18. We have 18 movement points. Now, although they started stacked in column, remember they cannot remain that way. And you can only move, you have to move one unit at a time and then move it, and then you can move the next one, right? So you can't just be moving guys, and you have to do things with them until they're done. So let's go ahead and we're going to keep the leader does not move until the end of the turn, by the way. So that's an interesting concept that we won't really see the implications of here, because this leader's range is, command range is 10. That's what that number means. And that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So he can command all the way up to the door from his initial spot. Leaders don't move, but they do move at the end of, I believe, formation chits? No, direct activation chits. They can move then. So when we draw that, you'll see the leader move. With a formation chit, they don't move. They just sort of stay there. So you have to sort of think about where your leader is and plan on putting them in a position so that if your units move, they don't move so far that they become out of command. Because if they're out of command, they can't do certain various game functions. Okay. And I don't think I have to discuss command, but I will just really quickly. Obviously, command is that little rating here, that 10, and units that are in there that are part of that unit's formation remain in command. Out-of-command units suffer various penalties. If that happens, we'll discuss it. I won't really go into it right now. Anyway, okay, so we have 18 movement points. He's in columns, so we know we get to move 2 movement points per hex until we get to the road. So let's go ahead and grab this guy. Oh, yeah. The fun stacking and grabbing. All right, come here, guy. All right, well, I'm just going to do it by hand because I cannot seem to grab this guy. We'll just take his column marker off because we know what he's doing. So let's zoom in a little closer. All right, so he's got 2 movement here. So we're going to go 2, 4, 6, 8. All right. So we have 9 movement points remaining. Now we're on the road, so it's one each. So we can go potentially 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and we're there, and we can start, busting down the door, right? Because that's the goal. We're going to try to get our units in there. We're going to try to get one in and get it unsuppressed, right? Well, the thing is that because there are no zones of control in this game, units instead project a fire zone. And this is one thing that the Vassal module does very well, and then playing in real life, you sort of have to make sure you either know or, just keep tabs of it. It can be difficult, especially when you have a lot of units that have overlapping fire, overlapping fire zones. For this purpose, like we said, though, only certain units can actually conduct opportunity fire because it's not their phase. And one of them is this unit. And as you can see, its range is 6. So that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it goes all the way out to that road there. What does that mean? Well, when you enter someone's fire zone, nothing bad happens right away. It's the people can enter the fire zone and nothing necessarily is triggered. It's when they start leaving or entering other hexes of a fire zone that you can conduct opportunity fire. And that's one of the more interesting aspects of this game. When you begin to enter another hex is when the effects are triggered. So what I'll show you here. So we've already moved, 9 points, right? Or 8 points. So that actually, if we have 10 points of movement left, I think I said 9 earlier. That was silly and wrong. We have 10 points. So what we do is we move 1 point here. So now we have 9 points left. Now, interestingly, if I try to move into the next hex, I trigger opportunity fire from this guy. Because he has a range of 6 and he can conduct opportunity fire. So what I would say is I'm going to try to move into here. And because I get forgetful sometimes and we're going to be doing a lot of talking, I'm going to remember that I have 9 MP left, right? So I went from here to 9 and I want to go from here to here. But that's when I trigger opportunity fire, because in this game, it's when you try to enter a hex or leave that hex, right? If I tried to reverse course, I would also trigger opportunity fire because technically I'm in a hex in the firing zone of a unit that can conduct opportunity fire. Now, if you leave the fire zone, the opportunity fire unit receives a penalty because you're actually leaving further than their range of fire, and so they're taking a very wild, kind of Hail Mary shot. As you get closer, though, they receive increasing bonuses because you're literally coming closer and closer to their more accurate range of fire. Right now, we're at the very extreme ranges for him, so we'll see how that works out. But anyway, I would say, okay, I have 9. I'm going to try to go this hex. I would declare my intent to do so, and my opponent would say, okay, wait. I'm going to try to do opportunity fire. So we come over here, and we look at the troop. What we have to do is you have to pass a troop quality check if you want to make sure I do that right. Let's check our handy dandy flow charts. All right. So the enemy unit performing an action that provokes opportunity fire. Are we firing with direct fire with our unit? We will be. Actually, we won't be. We'll be. Ooh, hold on a second. That's a great question that just brought up. This guy's a range of 6, but there is a certain range because he has a white value there. He has a dual purpose kind of weapon, so he does indirect and direct fire, I believe. So hold on, let me read the rules real quick and I'll be right back. All right, I'm glad I looked this up because it's one of the interesting elements as I'm learning the system. I have to sort of remember what these different weapons can do, because if it's direct firing versus indirect firing, indirect fire units cannot opportunity fire. That's basically the big thing I care about right now. So when I looked at the rules, we look up the fact that he's got a white 4 rating. And what that means is that he's actually a dual purpose thing. He has both armor piercing and high energy rounds. But because he's white, he can direct fire only. That means he can't indirect fire. And indirect fire means that, obviously, it sounds like if there's something that blocks LOS, but you have a unit that can spot the targeted unit, then you can do it. But if it's direct fire, it has to be no blockage of LOS. It has to be a direct line from the unit firing doing LOS. That's not a problem here. We got Desert Warfare, obviously not a lot of blocking things here. And we don't have a lot of barrage markers out, so it's not blocking the line of sight. So we are going to be able to do it because direct fire units can conduct opportunity fire. So I say, hey, I'm moving from this hex to this hex. And then we're like, okay, wait, I'm going to try to do my opportunity fire here. troop quality level is 4. We're going to roll that on a die. Actually, it's 5 because we're inside of the fort and we get a bonus. We don't pass. We roll a 7, so successfully move there. Oh, keep in mind, he's also in column this entire time, right? Like, I'm keeping that covered up, but he's literally got those kind of values on him. All right, so now we made it there. We now have, what, 8 MP. So now we say we're going to try to go there to use 1. And again, he'll be like, okay, the machine gun unit has a range of 2, but that's only up to here, so we're still in the range there. He's like, yes, I'm going to try to opportunity fire again. Roll. We fail again. Oh, this is getting interesting. So we're like, we'll try to go again here. So we have 7. We're going to try to do that again. He's going to roll. Fails it again. All right, so at this point, I could decide to leave column because I do suffer significant penalties for being in column, like defensive penalty. So I should probably think about leaving column, and I need to make sure I know how much that actually costs. And I feel like it's only 1 movement unit, but I want to make sure I know how much it is. Yeah, it's just 1 movement point, I thought so. It's when there's some units, and the reason I'm so confused is that some units have their own organic transport, and it costs 1/2 their movement points to enter that. I wanted to make sure column wasn't one of those weird half movement point things. So it is just 1 movement point here. So what did I have? We had 7, so we got 6. I could go down to 5 and reduce my column and leave column, which I think I will do now. Because I have 5 movement left. Well, should I press my luck? Because I only have 5 movement left, and if I'm not in column, the road becomes desert again, and it costs me 3 movement. I could just go 1 more, and that's it. Press my luck or don't press my luck, because I could fire. I am within range to fire at this gun. Ooh, that is very tough. That is very, very tough. And I might just try to go assault it as well. Let's keep pressing our luck here. So let's see. We had 7 to 6, so we're trying to go down to 5 movement. And we're going to do a reaction roll from the gun. Oh, this time it gets it. It rolls a 5, so it actually gets to opportunity fire. So in this case, we don't move to that hex. We stop and we resolve the opportunity fire. So let's actually use that flow chart. That would be nice. Alright, so here's what we're going to do. Alright, so direct fire. That's what this unit's doing. We pass a true quality check, so we know we can actually engage with the direct fire flowchart. So the target is within range, is a line of sight. So let's see what our fire rating is going to be. We're going to look at the modifiers for that. So there is a thing called a company bonus, and that's a +2 to your roll if you pass a troop quality check. When you're doing opportunity fire, you cannot qualify for a company bonus. That's just something that you can normally do when you direct fire, but when you do an opportunity fire, it does not come into it. So we look at the range. This is an armored unit, and what is the range here? We're talking 1, 2, 3 hexes. So at 3 hex range, oh, excuse me, -1. Okay, sorry. This is the first time I've looked at some of these things, so I'm just going to try to get the fire rating stuff all together right. So the range, if it's 0, you get a bonus. If it's the furthest hex away, you suffer a penalty. If it's in between, you sort of get a nice little -1. Okay, because it's a little bit further away, so it's a little harder to hit. But we're going to get a -1 there. Defense rating, now we add in the defense rating of the target. As we remember, because it's in column, it has that +2, so it actually is going to become a +1. Or sorry, it's going to become a +1. What else do we have here? Sorry I'm going so slow, but I'm reading this thing myself and I want to make sure I get it right. You also take into account the mass of the unit, and that's how many steps are in the actual hex. Right now there's 0 to 4 steps, so it actually gets a mass modifier of 0. This is where if you have a lot of units stacked together, you start to take penalties for direct fire, because even though one unit may trigger opportunity fire, or if the stack moves, the defending unit that can opportunity fire gets to choose which unit it fires at, but it gets these added bonuses if the stack is very large, right? So that's why moving together with units can be sort of perilous for them. It's not a night or a sandstorm, so we don't get any minus there. There's no mist. There's no unit status markers on the unit being fired on. It is a fire zone to a fire zone movement. That's so because he was in the fire zone previously and he moved to another hex within the fire zone. That's a +3. It's a very big bonus there. If you're leaving the fire zone, it's -1. And he's not entering a minefield or anything else, so there we go. So that's basically our totals here. We have 4 minus 1 is 3, so our grand total becomes a modifier of 3. This modifies his fire rating, okay? So that's what we're trying to figure out here. And I say he, and I'm not being very specific. This is the assault gun. It has a basic rating of 4, and we're going to... Or actually, it's got a basic rating of 5, because it's inside Beer Hachim. I forgot about that. A basic rating of 5, and we just figured out all those modifiers. That now becomes 8. All right, so following the flowchart, we now roll a d10. And if the result is less than or equal to the modified fire rating, then we can see what we do as damage. So we can see here that we have a pretty high chance of actually hitting the unit, because we have to roll basically not a 9. Right, because it's already a modified thing of 5, we got to add it on a 3 here. If you roll a 9, you always miss. Always miss. If you roll a 0, you always, or is it you? Yeah, if you roll a 0, then it's always pass. Alright, you rolled a 2, so that result is definitely a hit. So what we do is we cross-reference our weapon type and the type of target it is on the CRT here. So let's go ahead and take a look at the CRT. So you can see here we did dual purpose, because that was the white weapon here. The target was armored or entrenched, and we rolled a 2. So that is a suppression result here. So the combat chart is actually pretty simple. You can see it's not like crazy. The hard thing is just getting all the modifiers down. And if you watch my Roads to Leningrad series, I mean, it basically had the same idea of modifiers in the combat system, but it took getting used to, you know, figuring out all the numbers for that one. And it's going to be the same thing for me here. It's just going to take me a while to realize, oh, right, fire zone to fire zone. Oh, it's the range thing, so it's that. It's going to take me a while before those become automatic. So sorry that was a little bit of a slog through, but... There was, we did a whole combat, our very first combat. Way to go here in the Grand Tactical series. Okay, so the result was a suppression. Now, the thing about suppression is suppression keeps you from moving. It's a bad thing in this game, because movement and not being able to move, I mean, it can be bad. And if we look here at a suppression token, you can see here it gives you no fire rating. You can't fire at all. You get -2 to your assault and -1 to your troop quality rating, and you can't move. So suppression is just generally a very yucky status thing. If you get suppression, you can attempt to alleviate it, though. Units that take suppression can attempt to pass a troop quality check. If they do pass it, they can convert that suppression into a cohesion hit and keep moving on with their turn otherwise, correct? So what we're going to do here is we're going to try to do that. His troop quality rating is 5. So we just have to roll 5 or less, and we'll see if we can mitigate this into a cohesion hit. All right, we did it. So we rolled a 5. So the suppression result gets instead turned into a cohesion hit. So we've actually, what we've done is we've sort of sacrificed sort of our unit cohesion in an effort to just not get paralyzed by this artillery shelling. Cohesion hits. Oh, I guess we're going to get the green side here. Oh, we don't. Do we have green ones? Oh, we do. Nice. Cohesion hits themselves are not a huge deal. They do take away one from your fire rating and one from your soul rating, so that's not awesome. And if you stack them, you can get another one, and then things are getting worse for you because you suffer 2 from your fire rating, 2 from your assault, and 1 from your troop quality. But if you take another cohesion hit, then it becomes a step loss. So these things add up and become step losses. That's sort of how your units begin to wear away through attrition. So we're going to add this cohesion hit. Now, because we sort of mitigated the suppression result, we're going to be able to advance the hex. Now, this is the one thing you got to remember is that opportunity fire gets triggered when you enter a hex, not when you move into it and stop. It's like when you're trying to enter it. So you have to remember where you're going, especially if you're playing with friends. This goes faster, obviously, if you know what you're doing in the system, but I don't. I'm still learning. So it's slow for me. It's slow. But I'm getting, I'll get better. Okay, so here we are. We're now down to, what, 5 MP? Yeah, I believe so. Yeah, I think we had 5. I might be wrong there, but it's okay. It's just a learning game. So we had 5 there. What am I going to do? I could drop out of column and then take a shot here. And honestly, I could just drop out of column and try to move through a hex because that would give me... I still could move through there because it's just 3 movement points. So that's what I'll do here. Because I have 5, so I'll drop it down there to 4. Or was I already at 4? So if it was at 4, that would drop me down to 3. We'll say I had 4 and then drops me down to 3 because leaving column takes a movement point. So we'll say I have 3 MP now. I'm going to use that 3 MP and I'm going to try to just bring it. Just going to try to bring it. I'm going to go up here. And we're going to enter a minefield hex and trigger opportunity fire. So first, let's see. Only when you try to leave a minefield hex do you suffer the effects. You don't really suffer when you enter into it. So that's really okay. The only thing we're going to do here is trigger opportunity fire. Now, the other thing of those is that we're going to... that's okay here. That's right. Because I have a machine gun guy here, too. And he... Now we're getting range of his bullets. His withering fire. He can go 2 hexes. So you can see here we entered here, but that doesn't trigger his opportunity fire because I have to enter into another fire zone hex or leave his hex. I can't just like come from an outside one and enter into it and it gets triggered. So that's like the one thing. You can enter into it, but you can't go from a fire zone hex to a fire zone hex or leave a fire zone hex without triggering opportunity fire. Okay, that's how I should have said. That was very clear. We're going to try to go here. So that means I'm going to trigger opportunity fire from 2 different guys. First, we'll try doing this. First, we'll try the machine gun unit. He's got troop quality rating of 5. So because he's in the fort, that becomes plus 1. So he has 6. So we're going to roll the die. Nope. He rolls an 8, so he does not pass his troop quality check. Next, we try a check there. It's a 5. And he does not pass. Wow, so a lot of failed troop quality checks here. I guess the getting a little rattled here. And that's his entire movement, so he can't actually do anything else this turn. But hey, he at least got up to the front lines. That's actually quite impressive. Other times I play this on Vassal, they usually get shot the hell up on the way there. So that was just 1 unit. So now we come back over here. You might be thinking, oh my god, that took forever to move that unit. But, you know, we're learning, so it's going to take a while to get everything down. I want to go slow and make sure I get it right for myself. I mean, I'm doing this for other people to learn, but, you know, I'm trying to do it for myself as well. So we repeat the same thing, and we bring another unit up. And we're like, okay, that guy got through, so let's try this again. Maybe this time we'll try coming over here and seeing if we can get, since we got this guy up here, maybe we can try to divert around here and maybe sneak a unit in there. We'll see if we can do that. So we'll go 2, 4, 6, 8. Or let's think about this for a second, because now we have a unit. I mean, most likely they'll just get shot to hell, because they'll get activations. But if we think about his range here at 6, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it's really just this line of hexes here. Okay, so that's interesting. I'm going to put a little... All right, so what we're going to do is we're just going to say... 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. Yeah, that's what we're going to do. So we'll say we'll come into here. So we have, we've spent 10 MP. Or I should say we have 8 MP left. Oh, you know, it'd be smarter, Jay, to write down what you spent. So we have 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. We spent 10 MP, and we're trying to go into, we'll say, this hex. So that triggers opportunity fire over here. He fails. Man, this gun is just really whiffing hard here. It's just rattled. Crew is rattled. Alright, so it's got 12 MP. Now we'll try to come... Yeah, we'll just come over here. See if we can make that happen. So that could be 14, but again, we're going to trigger opportunity fire. This time, he actually does trigger opportunity fire. So now we do the whole thing of figuring out what's going on here. So let's go through those modifiers one more time. Hopefully a little faster this time because we did already did it once. So the range, we're going to be doing a versus an armored thing. Is it the last range of the hex of the range? Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. No, it's not. So he actually gets minus 1. So let's see those little things right here. So it's minus 1 there for the range. Then we look at defense rating. We know since he's in column, he's automatically going to also have a plus 1. And the other one, we know that the mass is 0 there. There is no night or sandstorm. It's not missed. There are no status markers other than the column. We've already figured that out. But he is moving from fire zone to fire zone, and that is a plus 3. Ooh, I just saw a modifier I think I messed up here, which is entering a minefield, plus 1. So technically, this guy would have gotten a plus 1 to his... Actually, he didn't get to fire, so yeah, I don't think that really worked out for them. If he does, then that would have worked out. That was my bad. Missed that modifier. Okay. So again, we twiddle these up. That becomes a plus 4. His fire rating is already 4, so you can see here that this gun has a very high, a good shot at, like, taking these units out. Because all we have to do now roll is roll, not a 9. So we take the die, we roll, we get an automatic hit. That's a 0. We cross-reference our chart again. It's a dual-purpose weapon. It rolled a 0, so it takes a cohesion hit. Dun, 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 dun. So that's really pretty good for the tank here, because I mean, you don't really want to take a lot of stuff, but it's not a suppression, so that means you can keep going. So yeah, he went here. So that's 14 now he's spent. That's how we should actually do it. So we spent 14. Now, I could drop out a column here, which I think I will do. So now we've spent 15. And what we'll try to do is we will enter this minefield hex and try to get closer. So once again, we're going to trigger opportunity fire. But we won't trigger opportunity fire from the machine gun because it's right here and this is outside its range. And I guess we'll... Oh. I did go there, didn't I? Yeah, okay, yeah, so I will trigger opportunity fire from... No, actually, I won't. That's right, because I'm just entering his hex, so it won't matter. But I will still trigger it here. So this is where you kind of have to remember about the entering hex rules and thinking about it, and I'm obviously working through it in my head, as you can tell. So what I that whole rambling conversation was, is I was thinking, well, would I trigger opportunity fire if I entered this hex here? And you wouldn't, because you don't trigger opportunity fire for entering into a fire zone hex unless you came from a fire zone hex. For a unit. So for this infantry unit, it wouldn't count because his fire zone is just what's directly around him. So me trying to enter this hex wouldn't trigger opportunity fire. But if I was, say, here and tried to go here, now that would trigger his opportunity fire. Now the other side of this, though, is that me trying to go in this hex does trigger opportunity fire here, as it has because I've been entering from fire zone to fire zone to fire zone, okay? So we're going to take our last movement points, and we're going to try to get right up there. And that's what we're going to do. So we're going to spend those, trigger that opportunity fire there. Once again, we got to roll a 5 or less. We do. All right, so he rolls a 2. So this time when we look at our modifiers, once again, we get the minus 1 for the range. This time for the defense, though, because he's not in column, he gets a minus 1 there. And normally we'd be taking into account terrain effects, but desert has no defensive terrain or anything. It's desert warfare. All right, so it's minus one, but we aren't going from fire zone to fire zone. So see, already I'm getting faster with these. That's plus 3. So it looks like we're going to have a plus 1 to our roll. So now he only has a 5. This is Oh wait, his fire rating's plus one. Oh god, I've been kind of screwing this up because I forgot what the inherent bonuses these units get for being in the fort. Technically, his fire rating is plus one when he's not moving and doing all that junk. So it's a five plus one, so it's a six. All right, so we roll. Nope, we miss. A nine is always a miss. So rolled a nine, totally whiffed it. That gun had a good bead on that guy. Not necessarily the greatest, because it is in tank form. And oh, it also would have gotten a plus one for entering a minefield. That was the one thing I should have added to this. So it actually would have been a plus two rank, because I would have been a plus one for entering a minefield. So that's one of those modifiers I'm gonna have to just remember in my head, right, for this game, because it's one of the ones that uses minefields. So that would have been a plus two. So just so we get the math right, remember, inherent bonus made it a plus one here, so it's a five base rating. This would have been a plus two. So I would have had to roll a seven or less, but I actually rolled a nine, and that's an auto failure. So wow, two tanks getting close to the walls here. Getting some really unlucky rolls from the old artillery gun here. And I think what we'll do is we'll go ahead and bring another unit down here, because let's just keep putting pressure here since we got that guy so close. And he could almost just snake around here and get in. So we'll do the exact same thing here. Oh, wait a second. Hold on a second. So the reason I had to take a break there is because I almost forgot one of the very key parts of having drawn a formation chit, which is what the game starts off with here for this little formation of these tanks. And that is that you get to perform any one action you want to do for free, and then in command units can spend can may perform a second action different from the first. That's not a non-engineer action, or it has to be different from the first and be a non-engineer action. And you can do that by spending a command point. And that's how we're going to get into some of this higher level aspect of the strategy in this game and the tactics and using your command points effectively. I forgot to do this because, of course, this unit could have done something up here. It got all the way to the walls. And we'll get a little closer here for it. Since he made it all the way there, we'll go close for him. So that unit made it all the way to the walls, and technically it could have performed a second action because I pulled the formation chit. As you pull other chits, you will be limited in what kind of second actions you can take. The formation one, of course, you can do almost anything except for what you just did. So you don't get double moves, double fires, that sort of thing. So technically, I could have assaulted with this guy from here to here. And I might actually try that out because the assault is sort of a pain. I've never really done it, but it would be something good to do here on in the learning game, right? Because we're trying to learn and see what's up. So what I would do is I would say I should have done that when this unit just moved. I should have done that before I even got this unit all the way down here, because you do every unit, you move it, you finish its actions, then you move on to the next one. I believe. Okay. Let me double check the rules. I say that, and of course, I'm like, is that really true? Or do I have to move every unit first, and then they get to do their second action? Let's see. Yes, you do it right when you finish the unit movement. So technically, when this unit finished moving, that's when I decide if it's going to get a second action or not. So I really shouldn't have moved this other guy. I really should have just tried to see what's up, because this guy might totally die here in this combat. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to decide what do we want to do with his second action. Now he could assault, which is a very long and interesting process. It's probably the only part of the game I don't think is interesting or elegant, and it's long and arduous, and we'll do it together because you have to do it, and partially because it's part of the victory conditions for my units here. But I can either assault or conduct fire. So what we'll do is we'll do a little bit of both here. What I think what I'll do is I will conduct fire here, direct fire, because I don't necessarily want to assault, although his assault ratings are not good, but there is an infantry unit underneath, and he does have assault ratings. All of mine is pretty good, just the two though. Well, what we'll do is we'll just, because it's a learning game and I'm not trying to be super strategy or awesome, what we'll do is we'll just do a direct fire with this guy, and this guy will participate in an assault. So there's just one unit there, and I think that'll be a little easier for me to handle the flow chart if there's just one on unit on one unit. Okay, so we come up here and we're saying, okay, he made it, and for the second action, I'm going to have him fire on that. It'll cost me a command point because that's what it does when you draw formation shit. And here are the command points. Let me move my things away. As you can see here, the Ariete division starts with six command points, and you get those. You get to replenish those if you draw your, I believe it's the direct activation, not the direct command, but the direct activation shit. And then we'll discuss that as that happens. So he starts off with six here, so we're going to spend one and go down to five. So we come back over here and say, all right. Firing with this guy, firing my tank. He has suffered a cohesion hit. He's a little busted up, but we're gonna fire at that unit. So we do the same thing we've always been doing, or that we've been doing with opportunity fire. Only thing is we can actually qualify for a company bonus here. So company bonuses are if a two-step unit, as we can see here, has two red dots, if it has not lost a step and is participating in sort of a direct fire, it can qualify for a firing bonus if it passes a troop quality check. It's possible you can pay a point to automatically pass that check. I don't think that works for opportunity fire or for troop quality checks. I think that works for other things, but once again, I'll double check on that rule and look that up because I'm just remembering that in my head. But we're going to say offhand that I don't think you can pay a command point to automatically pass this check. So what we're going to do is we're going to try to do a troop quality check, and let's see, his troop quality is five. The cohesion hit, just one cohesion hit does not reduce his troop quality there. As you can see, it just reduces his fire rating and assault. So his troop quality is five, we roll die, and he passes. Rolls a zero. So he's gonna get a plus two to his firing. So we get a plus two for troop quality check. Or for his company bonus, I'm sorry. His company bonus. All right, his range is one hex, so he actually gets a zero on there. That's fine, because that's actually the best you can hope for. Actually, this unit counts as armor, doesn't it? So it's still one, because I forgot. These units, normally he wouldn't count as armored. He's not an armored unit, but because of the special rules of French units being in the fort, he counts as an armored unit. So still don't get any modifiers, because it's just one hex away. So we look at the defensive rating of the unit. Now the inherent bonus is minus two because it's in the fort here. He inherently has a rating of zero, but he gets minus two there, so that takes away our little troop quality or our company bonus there. The mass, now this might actually help us out here. This unit's just one, but that unit's two, so it's a total of three steps in the hex. That's not big enough to qualify for anything. So it's zero, there's not a knight or a sandstorm, a mist, and there are no status markers on the unit we're firing on. So if we take our little bonuses here, we see we get zero. So it's going to be a tough shot. We're going to basically roll a three or less, actually a two or less, because we have a cohesion hit. So this is a very difficult shot indeed. Goodness gracious, we roll it a two. So man, the Italians, you know, motoring up, just rattling the gun crew, getting their shot off, even though they have a cohesion hit. So let's cross-reference what we got here. So we have a dual-purpose weapon firing on an armored or entrenched target. They kind of count as both. I rolled a two. That is a suppression. So, now, because it's a suppression hit, the unit can attempt to pass a troop quality check to get out of suppression. I want to say. Yes, you can spend a command point to automatically pass this if you want to, a suppression check. The thing is, my guy only gets two. Not having this gun is a big deal because, see, this is why I should have actually finished his attack first, because even though this was a low odds attack, if the suppression result had remained, this dude would have been able to come through pretty much unscathed. That's why suppression is such a big deal in this game. And honestly, his troop quality rating, even though it is 5, that's a f slightly better than half to do it. I think I'm just going to pay the point. We're just going to pay the command point. We're going to get a gun I want for the French, just to convert this into a cohesion hit. I can't afford to have that gun not moving or not operative. All right, so this tank, man, really comes through, gets the big shot off. So technically, I should have done that first, and then we would have moved this guy, and that actually would have improved him because, of course, now his fire rating is -1. He's taking a cohesion hit. Whatever, that's just how it goes, right? We're learning the game. So now we'll resolve this guy's second action. Again, I will pay a command point. We'll make it 4. And as promised, we're going to do an assault into this hex. This might be kind of stupid because he does have a cohesion hit, and his assault rating will thus become 1. But let's actually work through this together because it's something I want to do, even though I sort of dread it. So let's see if we need to do a bravery check. So the first thing you do when you do that is you need to do a bravery check. Oh, let me look at my cheat sheet. That's what I made. Okay. Yeah, I wrote this all out so that would be done. Okay. We check for bravery if the defender has armor, he's entrenched, or the attacking unit is attacking over a bridgeside. Now, because I said these units count as sort of entrenched and armored unit as a special rule, but if Axis units assault a Bir Hacham hex, they do not need to pass a bravery check. So, boom, automatically we know we don't have to do that. So we're going to go ahead and move up on the flowchart here. So do we need to do that? No. Defender gets to do opportunity fire. So they're going to fire at us. This is just because the units are now advancing up. It's going to, so assault is one of the few times you actually get to move into a hex, right? So this is actually the physical act of you trying to come into the hex and bring it. So now they get to do an opportunity fire on you. His troop quality rating is 5. It's quite good. He also gets a +1 for being in the hex, so pretty much most likely gonna get a shot off. He does not, though. Wow, the French units are really shaken in this one. Rolls a 9, not able to get off the opportunity fire. So this is a possibility that they could have suppressed the attacking unit or the assaulting unit, and the assault would have ended, or at least maybe put another cohesion hit if I had chosen to slag it off. But doesn't even get to do that. Doesn't get an opportunity fire in. So we're going to start the first round of the assault. At this point, we would eliminate all zero-step defending units. And this is also when defending units can choose to stand or run away. And those that run become suppressed, or those that run that later become suppressed or unable to move become eliminated, because you make this choice at this point to run away or not, and then you suffer the consequences later. So just for this battle, because we know we're going to lose if we let this unit in, we're going to stand and fight. So this unit's going to choose to, even though it did not pass its bravery check or didn't prove it pass its opportunity fire, it's going to choose to stand. Okay, so now we go to the next step. Assaulting units to declare charge or assault fire. So you can do up to 3 rounds of assault fire, I believe. Let me check that. Yeah, essentially you get to do assault fire, and you can do up to 3 rounds of that. And what assault fire is where the both units simultaneously fire at each other. Each unit fires twice, once with their fire rating and once with their assault rating. Unless their assault rating is in red, and then they get to, then it's twice with the assault rating. And then suppressed assault units stop assaulting. So you look at here and you say twice attack here, once with my attack, once with my assault. These are both not really great odds for me, although, you know, I mean, yeah, it's not really that great odds for me to attack this guy because it's, I'd pretty much get low rolls. He would have pretty good odds of hitting me and doing something because he just has naturally higher fire ratings. I could decide to charge. What would that do? And also, there's different fire and there's different. And And there's also some different like modifiers if you decide you're going to be using assault. See, this is why. I mean, it's obviously a lot more difficult than the direct fire or even indirect fires flow charts. I don't think I just have enough units, really, enough firepower to really go into simultaneous assault fire. I feel like I'm going to lose that infantry unit is, even though it is attacking an armored unit, and the chances of it getting a suppression are pretty low. I just wouldn't, I mean, my chances of hitting it would be pretty low as well because it's considered an armored target, and I would have difficulty getting any kind of good results on it. So I think we'll just do a charge. Let's just do a charge. And now, what do I do with a charge here? So let's see. Units that charged or ran away do not fire. Each unit fires if we did that. Okay, so we're going to charge. So what we're going to do is a troop quality check for charging unit. And I believe I can pay one to automatically pass that. Me see, hold on. Let me take a break and I'll be right back. All right, sorry I sort of stammer there. I really should just be taking breaks when I don't know the rules, but I've looked it up, and if you're going to not decide to do the assault fire and do the charge, then you make a troop quality check and you can pay a command point to automatically pass. I will do that because we're so close, so let's see if I can do it. We're going to automatically do that and pass. The non-active player must now make a troop quality check with one defending unit of their choice. So that has to be that guy, and he's going to have a rout of six. So we're going to roll it. He passes. If they had not passed, then the defending units would have run away and we would be able to finish it up. But instead, we're going to now go to step 5D, which is resolve assault fire. So now our defending units assault fire because we charge. So we're not attacking, and we don't get to the attacking units don't get to have any simultaneous fire. It's just the defending units now because we've passed our troop quality check. They've passed theirs. So they don't run away right again because we're charging them. They don't immediately just freak out and run away. They're gonna stay and fight it out. And so they're going to fire onto us now. If I have that right, make sure I have that correct. Now assault fire. And they get to fire twice at us. They get to use their fire rating and their assault rating because they don't have a red assault rating. So they get to use both of these when they attack us. And they have different fire modifiers. And they get plus two mainly for attacking a unit that charges. So we know that their fire rating is automatically six because they're in the unit and that's the Bir Hakeim bonus. So it's six. They get plus two because they're firing on a charging unit. So that's automatically an eight. And that's the only modifiers we have. So basically, we'd have to roll a nine to not have them get a hit here with their fire. They roll a six, they get a hit. A six, they have small arms fire here because of the pink value or red value, however you really want to call that. So they rolled a six on a small arms and they are attacking an armored target. A six is a cohesion hit. So it's another cohesion, but it's not suppressed yet. Or actually, we would have flipped that over and been like two cohesions. Now he comes at him with his assault rating and fires at him with his assault. That is a two rating. He gets, what does he get? A plus two because the guy is charging at him. So it's, what does he get? Assault. Oh, yeah, he gets plus one for that too. So his base rating's two, but he gets plus one for being in the fort, for being a French unit in the Bir Hakeim fort. So it's a three assault rating, right? And then he gets plus two because the guy is charging at him, so that becomes a five. So he has to roll a five or less. He does. He rolls a four. So if we look at a 4, if we look at the assault rating, that's a dual purpose number. And a 4 on an armored target is, wow, is that a step loss? That is a step loss. Still, let me see if I can remember which ones are step loss. All right. Yeah. Oh wait, no, it's of course you flip it over because it's already its own transport. Some of these units are have their own organic transport, so you have to remember how you do a step loss on those guys. But this guy you just flip over. So boom. Okay, so he survived both. He took a cohesion hit, took a step loss, but survived sort of the withering fire of charging. And let's make sure we get that. So we did that. Apply the results. Okay, so we look at the results, and if the results have a unit that is standing, we go to step 5F. So this guy's not run away. So we look at 5F. Active player may call off the assault. If the assaulting units call off the assault, it immediately ends and everybody stops. The assault is over if there are no defending units in the defending hex, or if there are no remaining assaulting units involved in the assault, or there have been 3 rounds of assault. And if it's not over, it continues with another round and you repeat step 5. Well, I'm going to stop because obviously I could keep going at it, but the only way it seems like I'm going to get this guy to budge is either like killing him through the return fire that I'd have pathetic results on, or having him fail his troop quality check when he attempts to see if he can check, you know, when we do the actual charge on him. So that's pretty interesting. I guess that's the only way you can really move guys. That was a good attempt. That apparently my only attempt was to get him to fail that check, but he didn't. I just took a step loss and a cohesion hit. So, I mean, that's the way that cookie crumbles. And so we take our final unit here, and we'll go ahead and do a lot of the same thing. We'll go ahead and bring him down the southern way as well. And he'll go 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. We'll say, yeah, let's see, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. He tries to enter their ranks. He's already spent 10 movement. He triggers assault fire from this gun, which now has a cohesion hit on it. So its fire rating, oh, I guess that would help if I actually showed you what's going on over here. So our gun over here has a cohesion rating, or cohesion hits. Its fire rating, it was 4, gets a +1 bonus rating in the fort, and now it has a -1, so it's back to being a 4. I only mention that if it gets this hit, I guess. It doesn't really suffer any troop quality effects there. An opportunity fire, of course, is triggered by troop quality. So his troop quality is 4, he gets +1 for being in the fort, a natural bonus, so we have to beat the 5. He gets a 2, so he's going to fire on that unit. He has a natural rating of 4. We just discussed that with a cohesion hit, but he does get a plus. Let's see. He is not going from a fire zone to fire. Oh, he is going from fire zone to fire zone, so it's +3. Gets a -1. It's not the most extreme part of his range, but it's anything. But it's not the closest either. And he doesn't get a troop quality bonus. Is that the only ones he gets on there? Oh, and the defense rating of the unit. Right. So it's also going to be another +1. So that's going to come out to be +3 to his rating. He has a 4, so he has to roll a 7 or a less on this. And he rolls a 7. So he gets a 7 on his thing. We cross-reference a dual purpose on an armored target, and a 7 is eliminated. So boom, the gun just clearly gets its way, totally takes out a tank right there. So you can see how really that's what the artillery gun should have been doing this entire time, is just mauling the Italian units. But instead, 2 kind of got close and, managed to make a little noise, make a little ruckus, as they say. So that was just one chit. That was literally the formation chit for the Italians there. So now we're going to come in here, look at the next chit that comes out. And it is division chit for the 132. So now, what do we do for division chits?
So we just did the formation chit. What's the difference? Well, division chits let you activate everybody in that division. Well, we only have one set of units, one formation out of that division here. So it's really not going to help us out very much, but that's exactly what it does. But when you also get a division chit, let's see, that's a direct activation. Let's just say what we do here. Yes, so if we get division activation chit, then what we do is we're going to start increasing our command points and also our dispatch points, but we don't have that in this scenario. So really we just increase our command points here. So the way you do that is you roll a die and you have the result and you add your division's command rating. So our command rating for this scenario is 2. So we're going to roll a die, have it, and add 2. It's 3. We have it and round down. That's 1. So 1 plus 2 is 3. We get 3 command points. So we're back up to 6. And this is the way you replenish your command points that you spend for doing additional actions and whatnot. All right, so now we can activate every unit in the division. They can perform one action except fire, assault, or moving into an enemy fire zone. And then in-command units may perform a second action different from the first and also one that's not an engineer action, and they can spend one CP. So here's where you can see that, and then leaders move at the end of this. So you want to keep your units in command because that way they can perform a second action. But the first action is limited. I can't fire, assault, or move into an enemy fire zone, which means I really can't do anything I really want to do with my units, right? So what I would do is I would pass. I would say, well, they're both going to pass for the first actions. Okay, that's fine. And then it becomes the second action. And then I can say, well, I'm going to spend both of them to fire and assault again, right? So you spend, we'll come up here and we'll spend a point and we'll attack that guy. If we spend a command point, we're down to 5. He's going to fire on him again. So we do the sort of direct fire. We look at our charts again. We're getting faster at this now. It's happening faster and faster. And what do we say? We say, okay. Boom. So we're going to do a company bonus. If we pass a troop quality check, we still have 2 steps, so we can qualify for that. We roll our die. We do not pass our troop quality check. We rolled 7, so we don't get our bonus here. We look at the range. It is a range of 0s, or it's 1 hex, so we don't get any modifiers there. The defense rating of the target is what's going to hurt here because it automatically gets a -2 defensive rating. So if you remember that, that's kind of what we get there. And then it has a cohesion hit, but it does not affect its defensive rating or anything else. So we just get a -2 to our modifier. That means that our fire rating, which is already a 2, becomes a 0. That means we would have to hit... we'd have to get a 0 to actually hit this target. So we roll a die, and we don't. We get a 6. I could have attempted to rally. I didn't think about that. Rallying... I just want to rally. Other actions. Rallying is how you remove cohesion hits. Okay. Yeah, if it's daylight and the unit's in an enemy fire zone, then I can have the unit make a troop quality check. If it passes, it removes any suppressed marker from it, but not any cohesion hits. Oh, okay. If it's daylight and the unit's not in an enemy fire zone, or if it's night and it is in an enemy fire zone, then it can make a troop quality check, and if it passes, it rallies successfully, and then it can remove cohesion hits, but only at night. And if I was not in enemy zone of fire zone. So both these units can't remove cohesion hits because it's daytime and they're in enemy fire zones. If they were outside enemy fire zones and it was daytime, they could rally and remove cohesion. And if it was nighttime, they could do it, but not in the daytime. But you can always attempt to remove suppression because suppression is such a brutal negative effect that the game allows you to do that. So I could have rallied as one of my actions and tried to use a troop quality check to remove it, but because I'm in enemy fire zone, that wasn't going to work. And we'll go ahead and just sort of see if we can fire on this guy. I mean, it's obviously going to be kind of pointless, right? Because this guy's just going to basically be able to hold out. So, and actually it'll be more than pointless because he has 2 -2 cohesion hits. I could try to move around here, although I can't move from fire zone to fire zone. I could for my second action, though, because you don't get any of the prohibitions on your second action because you spend a command point to do it.
But then I would basically be taking all sorts of fire. I could come down here and just try to avoid that guy. Yeah, let's try to sprint down here and let's see if we can do it. But he is not in columns, so let's take a look here. Yeah, we'll try this out. Let's see if we can make it happen. He's only got... Oh, but he has severed one there. So we'll go here. We'll try to go there. That's three movement. That triggers opportunity fire up here. Nope, he misses. So that's three. And we'll go into this hex. Oh, he does trigger opportunity fire here. This actually could have technically qualified for the win to get in that hex unsuppressed. So he's going to get his firing there. It's the same kind of thing we've been doing before, right? Because it's opportunity fire, so he doesn't qualify for a troop quality or company bonus. We look and say... Oh, I gotta pull the Shi'ar because I just don't know him offhand well enough yet. Oh, the range. Of course, it is not his furthest hex, but it is also not the closest, so he gets a minus one. We add in his defensive rating value, which is still minus one, because cohesion hits really don't affect the defensive rating yet. So that's a minus one there. But he is moving from fire zone to fire zone, and that is a plus three. And so we have three, four, five. Was that plus one? So he gets a plus one to his fire rating. And what does that become? So it is four. It's a minus one for the cohesion, so that's three. But then it gets plus one for being inside the Bira chain, so it's a four. Looking at a total four here. Oh, then he gets plus one. So it becomes a five. So he's going to roll five or less. He rolls it. He rolls a four. So a four on the dual purpose on an armored target is a step loss. So this guy is toast. He gets eliminated trying to go into that hex. And that's the end of that turn, right? Because that's all I can do with my units there. I've fulfilled all their actions. So now we look in the chit cup and we say, who's next? Well, it's a divisional activation thing for the free French, so this is where we get to see if they get more command points. We roll a die and have it. It's six, so that's three, and we add their command rating, which is three, so they get six more points. So they're up to seven now. And then they can basically take the whole range of actions that I just did, except they cannot, what is it? Remember our restrictions again. If you draw the division activation chit, then you may have every unit in that division perform any one action except fire, assault, or move into an enemy fire zone. So what we're going to do is just pass with these guys, and then we're just going to have these guys attack by paying command points. So we will actually have this gun fire first, and then we'll have the mortar and everybody else participate. Let's see if the gun can get it done. So we'll pay, basically we're going to have one, two, three... four units attack, so I'll go ahead and pay four, just go down to one. We'll see if we can't just wipe out this guy here. Okay, so let's do a mortar attack first, because that's the one thing we haven't done yet is indirect attacks. Now, indirect attacks work because it's not an opportunity fire. And the other thing mortars don't get is they don't get the company fire bonus, because mortars would be just way too powerful if you could do that. Okay, so we look at its fire rating, and we look at sort of the indirect fire flow chart, which is pretty easy as well. Or mortar fire flow chart, I should say. Is it within range? Yes. Is it self-spotting? Yes. The mortar can see it. There is no line of sight blockage. Units do not block, unless there's a barrage marker, do not block line of sight. So you can self-spot, modify the fire reading, select the target unit, and roll a d10. So we look at our... It pulls the same kind of modifier amount of ratings as we've been doing for indirect fire. Or for direct fire, as we've been doing with the gun up there. Sorry, I'm not using very good English. So let's take a look at what our ratings are. I don't believe a mortar can pass troop quality. Or get a company bonus for... I don't believe they can. But it says it can. So we'll do it this time, but I'm not sure. I'll have to dive deeper to make sure that mortar units don't necessarily qualify for that, but we'll see if he can. So he has a rating of four, but it's a plus one because he's in the thing, so he does not get it. He rolled a nine. Okay, so we look at the range,
And we see that the range is not the furthest away, but it's also not the closest, and it's armored. So what does he get here? He gets minus one. This should be easy to remember. I should be getting these down. The defense rating of the unit does come into effect, so that's a minus one. The mass does not matter. Knight or Sandsword's miss. And it does have a cohesion hit, but that does not mean anything for its defensive rating. And we don't have any status markers. So we're going to get a minus two to our rating here. That means we have a total value of one. And we're going to roll that. Oh, so close. I roll a two. So I miss it. But what does that mean? Well, whenever you use an indirect fire thing or a mortar, you lay down barrages anytime you do a hit. If the power of the unit is, I believe, five or less, then you only can throw down light barrages. But if the firing rating of the unit is six or greater, it throws down heavy barrages. The light barrage does terrible things. It reduces fire rating, reduces your assault, reduces your movement, and it costs 2 MP to leave the hex. If you do a heavy barrage, then it reduces your fire rating by 2, assault by 2, your troop quality by 2, and it costs, you have to do a troop quality check just to even try to leave a heavy barrage hex. So automatically this guy is just hurting. He's got a cohesion hit, he's got a light barrage. So now what we're going to do is we're going to fire on him with this gun, and this should probably take him out. So we look at the ratings, we say, what's up? The range is closest, so he actually gets a zero. He can try to, he can't qualify for a company bonus because he's a one-step unit. Only two-step units can. So the range is just one hex, he gets zero versus armor, yeah. Defensive rating here, it's still an armored unit, so it gets minus one. So that's it, we get minus one to our fire rating. Which remember is 4, minus 1 cohesion hit, but also plus 1 for being there, so it's back to 4, minus 1 is 3, so we gotta roll a 3 or less. Alright, we rolled a 2. A 2 on a dual purpose, hitting an armored target, produces a suppression result. So I could attempt to negate this suppression result by passing a troop quality check, which I will just try to do just for the sake of argument, because you should always try to avoid suppression if you can. So I'm going to try to pass a troop quality check. I am already hurting because I'm under a light barrage. So I'm going to pay a command point. I'm going to spend my very last command point as my guy here. That's probably not what he had. But anyway, I'm going to spend a command point to automatically convert this to another cohesion hit, so he's going to take 2 cohesion hits. And then we're going to have this, finally we're going to have this guy fire on him, this infantry unit. So he's going to have, sorry, I'm moving all these markers around, I'm not being very, very clear here. I'm trying to be, so you can see how the counters can kind of get the way, but it's not so bad really. So we do the same thing again. We're gonna look here. He can qualify for a company bonus. He's a two-step unit, so we're going to roll. He does get it, so automatically you get a plus two. The range is one, so he doesn't get any fire range bonuses or negative modifiers. We get the armored unit factoring in there. And that's it. Okay, so I'm getting faster at this automatically. So we get a plus one to our rating. He has an automatic rating of 5, plus 1 for being at 4 to 6, plus 1 is 7. He rolls a 0. Actually, that kind of flowed out. There we go. Roll a 6. In a 6, he's a small arms guy. And attacking an armored unit, he gets a cohesion hit. So, boom. Another cohesion hit. He already has 2, so he suffers a step loss. And that's pretty much the end of their actions. And I think I'm just going to stop it here because it's pretty obvious that the Italians are not going to be able to get into the fort. You know, they're already suppressed, or he's already suffered so many cohesion hits, and he's got barrages. It's going to be very difficult for him to actually push units around. But you can kind of see how this game works now, right? Units approach, the firing zones can be just absolutely brutal. Getting the barrage markers definitely sort of key for mortar units. They can lay down this barrage fire, which does block line of sight, but it also imposes sort of troop quality negative modifiers. That's big firing modifiers, and also increases the movement rate to get through something. The heavy barrages, even more so, they can really pin units down. Not quite as good as suppression, but they have to pass a troop quality check just to get out, or pay to MP to leave. We didn't really talk about minefields because they didn't really get past them. They do cause you to perhaps take a suppression result. So yeah, that was sort of a little demonstration of combat in the game. A little bit of how assaults work. You can see they're a little... I drew them out as my very first assault. It obviously goes much faster if you know what you're doing. You can see I got much better the direct fire and indirect fire results. So it's just like when I played Rhodes, you just have to learn the modifiers. You have to learn sort of what they are and how they work. But, you know, easily graspable. I was able to pretty much do it here on camera. Not too many huge issues. Sort of stammered and whatnot. But, you know, that's to be expected when you're learning a game. Okay, so that was the training scenario for one. We didn't get through even all the chits of the first turn. I still had... What did I have? The direct command chit for the Free French and the direct command chit for the Italians. And just so we can go over that, because I want to make sure I talk about all the chits, because this is a learning game. The direct command chits, what they do is they let you activate any number of in-command units by spending one command point per unit and having each perform any one non-engineer action. So you can only do one action, you don't even get the option of doing a second, and you have to spend a point, but you can activate anybody that's in command. So when you start having many divisions out there and each division's different formations, getting this chit lets you activate everybody. So it's sort of like the big time activator, even though everybody just gets to move once and doesn't get to do another action. So in that case, if I had more French forces, they would all get to move. But, you know, with such a small scale battle, the direct man chits really don't mean as much. Okay, so that was the first scenario. I sort of stumbled through it. I hope you learned a little bit, or at least kind of understood how the system works. It's really not too complicated, honestly. I played this, and this wasn't too bad. I could see it getting a little sticky if you had a lot of these markers to deal with, if you had to remember movement rates, and you didn't have Plexi. I mean, that could be difficult for... That would be hard for me. Like, I would have to write these things down. And also keeping a track of the firing zones, entering fire zones. That's not so hard when you start doing it. Sort of rule of when you enter into a hex and then you trigger opportunity fire. That could get sticky if you had a bunch of units and you're trying to remember who moved where and you're not very fast at resolving these things. But then again, if they fail their troop quality check and don't conduct opportunity fire, then that's a pretty easy move. So anyway, that's the first scenario. Not a lot of crazy terrain, but we did get to use column, did get to move, did get to see opportunity fire, direct fire, indirect fire. We did struggle through an assault, and didn't quite push a unit, didn't quite get victory, but did pretty well here. So yeah, that's the introduction. If I feel like tackling the larger one recording, I may, but this is so detail-oriented and without having the additional additives that Vassal brings to it, such as automatically modifying units and having an automatic battle calculator, it goes a little slower. Yeah, but I just want to get it out there and let people see what the system is like. I'm pretty intrigued with it. I liked everything so far. I would like to see more smaller battles like this. I think that'd be fun. So anyway, that was No Question of Surrender. No Question of Surrender.